this week, Governor Rick Scott was in Miami to sign a hard-fought piece of immigration legislation, House Bill 851, giving Dreamers the right to in-state tuition. The bill also lowers tuition for students across the board, kicking off what is being touted as, quote, a college affordability tour, end of quote. Joining me to discuss this and more, we welcome Dr. Sean Foreman, Associate Professor of Political Science at Baylor University, and Dr. Charles Zelden, Professor of Legal and Constitutional History. Welcome all to the program.
Thank you.
Sean, let me start with you. House Bill 851, this was championed by Representative Jeanette Nunez from Miami-Dade County very successfully.
Yes, that's the bill that will allow undocumented immigrants to receive in-state tuition to our state colleges and universities. And that was a big one on the agenda for the Republicans, believe it or not, and particularly Rick Scott. And I say that because in the past, that's been an issue that's been pretty heartily opposed by Republicans in Florida. Although you did have the Miami-Dade delegation, which stood tall, and Representative Jeanette Nunez, who does get a lot of credit here, and Rick Scott gave her massive credit at a signing ceremony earlier this week, the Greater Miami Chamber of Commerce Goals Conference. He showed up, and it was sort of a low-key signing of the bill, but then he came out and made this announcement in Miami and gave copies of the bill to the representatives. And this is supposedly going to help get Hispanic votes in November. We'll see. It could have backlash, particularly in the northern part of the state, but this is one way that Republicans think they can make electoral inroads with Hispanics.
There was some resistance by the legislature, but House Leader Bill Weatherford led the charge. The Senate, which tends to be much more liberal, Senate Leader Don Gates was much more reluctant until Bill Weatherford said, "You want a budget? Well, guess what? And you want to leave on time? Guess what? You have to pass this first."
That's the way politics works in Tallahassee sometimes. It's you cut deals. The other important part, though, is not just the Dreamer part, but the capping of tuition at 6% increase, and then only for FSU and UF, and then lower tuition for the other state schools. The problem is, will the state make up the difference? The reason why we had the 15% increase in tuition that was permitted was because the state was giving less and less money to the state universities and colleges.
Many universities and colleges today would say that they are more state-assisted institutions than state-financed institutions.
Some people would say state-sponsored rather than even state-supported or assisted, because the amount of money that comes from the state has gotten less and less over time. Throw in the cut in the amount of money to be given for Bright Futures, and you have tuition being lower, but the amount of money the state provides to support that is lower, so the student still ends up paying more money.
And yet part of the conversation is rising tuition bills for students and for everyone who pays taxes, for that matter. And I think that's one of the parts of the conversation that doesn't really get addressed. Why is tuition continuing to rise in public as well as private institutions?
Well, there's a lot of reasons for that. And part of it is, you know, universities are businesses that have operating costs. They have to pay for electricity, they have to pay for insurance, they have upgrades. And so people don't think about that when they look at the cost of tuition that has to be rolled in. I actually wanted to mention, yes, that's part of the grand bargain to get that through, and Governor Scott can now claim some victories on education. But this could be problematic for Republicans nationally, if not in Florida, because, you know, we're seeing in the southwest border right now, currently, a bunch of people coming across the border, particularly younger
people.
Especially
unassisted youth or children.
You know, because we usually, the word is children who came here through no fault of their own, or it wasn't their decision, and they lived their whole life in Florida, and now they should be able to go to college. But now we're seeing children who are coming on their own or making that decision. So it may open the floodgates to more people coming here.
They're not doing it on their own in the sense that it requires money. And
But they're coming by themselves.
But they are unassisted. They are coming alone.
It is not the equivalent of you're 4 years old and your parents come and they bring you along. These are older children who are cool.
You do have 3 to 16-year-olds who are being currently detained by the U.S. Border Patrol agents and a three-year-old coming alone. Somebody orchestrated that because the three-year-old didn't do it alone. Redistricting, Charles, doesn't get a lot of attention, but in the court system, it is. What's going on?
Well, the problem,
gerrymandering.
Yeah, it is gerrymandering. And the problem is the state legislature, when they drew the maps, drew maps that just happen to be the same maps as a Republican think tank had put out that just happened to be advantageous to the Republican Party. And so there was a big fight over access to the emails and the notes of that process to see if there was collusion. And now it's those. Now that information has been viewed by the court has to make a decision, was this an improper gerrymander, and if it was, we go back to different. We have to draw new maps,
and that might affect elections this year.
Not this year. It won't happen in time for 2014, but it could throw a wrench in 2016 with our districts. What's interesting is it looked like it was a very transparent process because Senate President Gates and Speaker Weatherford went around the state. They had hearings. I went to one at Miami-Dade College. I said, "We want your input. We want you to draw maps." And now it looks like that might have been all charade. And one of the maps they used
was there was a student who was they applauded. Yes, he gave this map, and we used part of it. And he said, "That wasn't mine." I mean, there was a bit of a charade going on here.
Gerrymandering happens on both sides of the aisle, but clearly it looks like this one is a little bit more suspect than not. There should be a decision by the end of the month, correct?
If the court has any hope of it of affecting the November election, which is probably not going to happen, they'll have to rule quite quickly. But it's in the judge's hands, and the judge will rule.
We have a possible rematch. Bogdanoff versus Sachs in Broward County.
Yes, and in fact, the redistricting process actually drew those two incumbents against each other last time. Republicans seemed to do that to want to get rid of Bogdanoff or put her
Ellyn,
right, and so she's just jumped in the race this week, and that'll be one Senate race to watch. You know, the
Why
district
do Republicans
does,
not. Want her in?
I think she upset the leadership in the past session, and I need to look back. It was something on education, it was something on gambling that she went against the leadership, and so they drew her district in a way that put her in this.
Not being a team player is not a good thing, Charles.
No, definitely not. And also the way the numbers played out, and the way the politics of Broward County and Palm Beach County are shifting. They had to lose a Republican district. I mean, there was no way to create a Republican and a Democratic district in that area.
Well, what's interesting now is a potential future Senate Speaker, Latvala, is supporting her and wants her in that race to try to get him another vote for Senate President.
Medical marijuana, very quickly.
Yes, well, we have this vote in November, and it's going to get more interesting because now Sheldon Adelson, a Las Vegas casino magnate, put $2.5 million into a super PAC. So we're going to see a lot more ads now that are going to counter the pro-medical marijuana people who have been out there all alone so far.
LGBT group endorses Charlie Crist.
Not surprising, given the Democratic Party and the general ties between the LGBT community and the Democrats. I mean, there was one question because when he was governor and a Republican, Charlie Crist did come out against marriage equality, but even then it was somewhat half-hearted, and he's basically, as many Democrats have said, my views have changed.
And I think the whole country, that's one issue when you see change in opinion in a 10-year period where everybody has gone just many.
In terms of civil rights issues, this change is so fast. We've never had a change this fast in civil rights.
And I think millennials had a lot to do that, to drive that conversation. I'm out of time. I'd like to thank my guests for joining me. Remember to look for us on Facebook, Issues with Helen Ferre. Thank you for watching. Happy Father's Day.